It is my great pleasure to introduce to you our keynote speaker. His keynote is Raymond Lorenzo's. Keynote is Imagining and Designing the Future in Italy, 1977 to 2014, Children's Participation in Urban Planning. So, Raymond Lorenzo, a very old friend of mine, is also a city planner and a professor at the Umbra Institute in Perugia, Italy. He is the founder and scientific director of the Abicita Cooperative in Milan. He has worked for over 35 years in Italy, the United States, and other countries for local authorities and NGOs to disseminate and consolidate the principles and approaches of participation in diversified areas, including rights and opportunities of children and youth in the urban context, urban design and planning, sustainable development, among other matters. He has worked as a researcher and a docent in such universities as Harvard, City University of New York, the Open University and IUAV in Venice. He is the author of numerous scholarly articles, such as City Design and the Renewal of Childhood, as well as Seven Realms of Children's Participation, a Critical Review, and books related to the above themes, such as Andate a Giocare nella Strada, 2014, In Città ci abito anch'io, 2000, Le città sostenibile, partecipazione, luogo, comunità, 1998. In Italia, più tempo e spazio ai bambini, 1992. Please welcome Raymond Lorenzo.
Buonasera. I'm really honored and happy to be here at the Calanda Institute. And I have to say, when Joe told me, I was planning to come to Italy anyway in the same time, and I really wanted to come for this conference. So I put together this proposal of a paper, a presentation really more than a paper, and didn't expect it to be in the group. Then discovered that I was the keynote speaker, got very honored. Then Joe said, well, you know, you just didn't fit in. It was like hard to get into any of the other roundtable discussions. So then I thought, oh my God, I mean, it's like, you know, this is the Calanda Institute, Italian-American Institute. I'm Italian-American. I've lived in Italy for 40 years now. So I hope you excuse me. I felt like I really had to make this paper this presentation very personal, a personal voyage, because effectively it's not a research presentation about what's been going on in Italy in this field, but it really is, since I've been more or less in the middle of this in Italy for the last 40 years in participation with children, that I try to travel it through chronologically and give you ideas of what children are like there, why participation is important, and I should put on the slides, though. This is, I need help. Sorry. Let's get that out. Thought I had my first slide up there, which is, excuse me. That's a little bit better now, okay? It's hard for anyone in Italy to think about the future. I have to say that. I mean, it's difficult to plan the future in a country such as Italy. And it's extremely difficult to work around themes with children like that. But that's why the subtitle is Nostro Futuro or Il Mostro Futuro. Our future or no future, we could say, or the monster future. It goes way back. Really, I said I'd make this personal, but we'll get into some themes because I know it's not, you're not, I'm used to talking to people from city planning, participatory education, collaborative education, probably some of you have those backgrounds. So I want to give an idea of the principles and the theories why I feel, and many scholars and activists feel that participation is good for children, it's good for us, for adults who can receive from the children their ideas, and it's good for the city, and primarily. We really feel that the cities cannot be changed without children and youth participation. And it begins, and this is the secret agenda of my life's work, is really trying to get everybody in the world back to the streets of Brooklyn. I grew up there. I really feel that, you know, Sunday afternoon, my Uncle Mickey, and I'm very emotional because I have a couple of my cousins in the room also, so one of which I haven't seen in 21 years, which is incredible. And Uncle Mickey, you remember, used to say, get out of the house. Why don't you go play in the traffic? He said a lot of other things that were more funny than that, but I won't get into them now. But that is really my, because, you know, childhood has to be lived in the open airs. You know, we know that children should be in nature, but there's something about a city. I mean, children learn from cities. And that, in that case, we were a group. We collaborated together. We had autonomy. Our ideas and decisions, which were projects, and this is participatory design, didn't have to be influenced by adults, although there were a lot of adults around the community that were watching us, I see some people, and controlling it and taking care of us and throwing water on us, whatever, but just getting things going. So you're part of a community, and that's something that we think is missing from today's world. That, don't think of that as me. That is me, but it's to say, where does participation come from? How did I get into this? Because I'm a city planner. Usually most people think that city planners are good planners. I'm not a planner. I have a hard time planning my life also. But I grew up and studied in an epoch, in an era. I was at Columbia in 1968. And I remember when my family, my mother in particular, wanted to send me to Columbia, and everybody in the family said, don't send him there, he'll become a communist. They were wrong, I became an anarchist. You know, in the good sense, a Fabian socialist and person that believed really in democracy and in the importance of not working only with experts or allowing experts and politicians to decide our lives for us, but to work together to make better decisions in whatever field we're in. And I put in there architecture without architects. Many of the people, this is kind of the influence. How did I get back to Italy? Because I was an Italian-American, certainly felt Italian-American, thought Italy was anything south of Naples. We're from Basilicata. But I had no idea I was going back to Italy until I started exploring Italian architecture, discovering that the region that I came from, Basilicata or Puglia, and areas like that was one of the places most cited in a very important book, Architecture Without Architects, by Bernard Radofsky, which talked about vernacular architecture and how people, once upon a time, knew how to make their environments, didn't need experts or adults. They were all part of a community that understood why a door should be in a certain position, why it was sustainable development. Sustainable architects talk about regionally based. And that got me going. Get to Harvard, walk in, and it was, again, 68, 75, a lot of radical teachers around, community participation strong in my school. The first day, the teacher shows us a slide of Pruitt-Igoe. I don't know if you know that. It was a very important public housing project in St. Louis, actually designed by the same fellow that did the Twin Towers, unfortunately, both came down for more tragic reasons in the first case. But this was a place that was built, won architectural awards, was loved by all architects and art critics. And after 10 years of people living in there in modern architecture, which forced people to live in places that were not like the streets of Brooklyn, where there were not stores, people watching, workplaces, you know, an unzoned, multi-zoned place. Here, the residents, after crime and desolation set in, decided and voted to knock it down. And my professor said, don't always trust, you know, the decision makers in this case. We have to look a little bit deeper into this. And maybe children would never do that. But it's an old story. So while I was there, I mean, you know, certainly, I hadn't mentioned the street corner society. That was the first point. I mean, take a step back. While we were studying street corner society, many people know that, I'm sure, you know, I, as an Italian American, thought, sitting in a room in Colombia, what is this? Seems like common sense to me. You know, why are we saying that it's so strange that there should be a pecking order, or that relationships in places, in outdoor places, are formed for a certain reason or other. And I began to form my research interests about that. Did my first papers on growing up in Brooklyn, understanding what the form of the street, how that contributed to a way of life, how people were able to watch and control and take care of each other, you know, in a free sense. And then I discovered that this is a field. I mean, there are people who were writing about this for years and years. I mean, a neighborhood, Margaret Mead, influence. And one, a seminal piece said that, you know, if you want to design a good city, you have to begin with children's interests, because children can get to know each other, to know society, to observe ways of work, places of culture, and to build the type of relationships that are necessary to build a strong person, you know, a well-balanced person and a well-balanced society. Children at the center of our society, so we need to work towards those themes. You know? But things were already changing. Cities were not already in the 40s and 50s. Paul Goodman, who was a strong influence of my work and many people's work, I hope, already noticed with his brother, who was a professor of architecture, Percival Goodman, that the cities were no longer fitting for children. And what were the reasons to go into that? Certainly, we know automobile traffic, dangers, hidden technology. What does that mean? Not being able to understand the way things work. Okay? The mobility and the change of family structure. There was no longer, and then these are positive evolutions, women going to work, the family's not at home, but children were no longer in a community so they could really deal with the neighbor. And first, most of all, nature was receding from cities. I can still remember in our neighborhood, there was still in the 50s, horses from the countryside would come in with produce. You know? You could walk down to the river, you could get to it. You could go into the water, you could find little pieces of nature still existing in the city. These things were disappearing, so we needed to do something to change that. At the same time, again, the participation comes in. We know the reasons for these things. The research has been done, but in order to change a society or change a way we live in a city, people and children primarily need to get into this process and be able to bring forth new ideas, open up conversations, discussions about questions, participating or being part of a process in which you decide something and you make something together creates ownership, a sense of belonging. People feel more attached to the neighborhood or to the street, to the home when you can leave your sign. It became participation. I wrote, this is a later slide, so participation is a right in society, although how many of us actually decide in that period what's going on behind the scenes in the economy or in city design in particular, in city planning. Children have a right to participate. They didn't have it in the 70s, and I'm still back there. I haven't gotten to Italy yet. But in 1989, they received this right to participate and to have a voice in things that affect them in 1989 with the Children's Rights Convention. Talk a little bit about that later. Stimulates democracy. I feel that participation is the way we work on it, it's a collaborative learning process. Getting to sit down together with people and explore a place, discuss problems, get to know each other, you understand the competencies, the values, the ideas and creativity of the others, and together we produce places that are more suitable, more just, and more sustainable, because we take care of them, because we've been a part of it. And it's a lot of fun also. This is getting a little long, but I think I should go through this quickly. This is a jump into the future. In 2001, sitting down with a dear friend of mine, Mark Francis, that we began together back in the days of participation in the mid-70s. He's a landscape, actually retired professor emeritus of Davis College, Davis University, the University of California in landscape architecture. And we sat over a couple of bottles of aquavit. He's in Norway now. And so we wanted to see what were the roots of all this interest in children's rights, children's well-being in cities, and the idea that children could participate. So we went going through our heads in the literature, and I'm presenting this now to give you an idea, because it's not your field, to give you an idea of like where all these ideas came from. There was a whole aspect in that period, the more political aspect of participation was called advocacy, not only for children, but for adults, planners. You remember, maybe some of you remember the urban villages by Gans, you know, not neighborhoods, traditional so-called ghettos that were healthy cities getting knocked down, and the movement was built up to stop urban renewal. At that point, planners were working in an advocate's manner, trying to help them, but deciding for the people, not really evaluating or, you know, developing a participatory process, advocating for their rights. The same thing happened with children. The needs issues, I mean, Margaret Mead underlines that, but there were many, many other people and colleagues at the Graduate Center across the street and friends, et cetera, who were working on this many, many years ago, just to think about and study what the needs of children are in cities. Sociologists, anthropologists, environmental psychologists. A whole other angle that came into this was the movement in the late 60s and 70s amongst architects and educators that the city could be a learning environment, so that we should really allow children and create ways that children and people can understand better the way cities are made. Some schools actually in that period, and I think they still exist, maybe, correct me if I'm wrong, they used to be city as school, et cetera, and some of the public systems, maybe they closed, where children acquired, I think Kathy's kids did some of that, but that they could acquire an education through exploring the city and working, going into workplaces, going into homes. Romantic, maybe Paul Goodman could be put into that place, and I think I am too. Mark and I had a debate about whether we should call it romantic or utopian, but it was the idea that children could be planners, that children might be able to decide. That's why I put that kind of provocative title in there, because the children would never design. Children who are intelligent, and if we help them to work together and think about what the conditions of their lives are, would never come up with a solution like 1,500 apartments without any services, isolated outside a city. You know, that just doesn't work, you'll see. So the question remained, do we want mani sulla città? And the people from the Institute know Francesco Rossi's film, you know, the corruption in Naples, politicians and big business deciding how people should live, or manine sulla città, little hands, which are children's hands, but they're children and citizens that work together to try to build or decide better cities. So, finished my education. I hope I gave you a little bit of an idea of what the roots of this kind of work are, or have been. I went back to Italy in 1975 to explore my roots, actually with Mark Francis. We were studying together. He went to Norway, his roots were there. I went to Naples and to southern Italy. I got married in Naples. He was married in Norway. He went back to the United States. So it was something that, you know, the roots set up. My wife is here also. I'm very happy that. But before going to Naples, I took a little trip through the towns of my grandparents, San Fele in Basilia Potenza, Milionico, and discovered the children were very similar to the children I knew on the streets of Brooklyn. They were out. They were working together. They were building things. They were being autonomous, you know, resilient children that were able to create a place for themselves, in poverty in many cases, but with a gusto for life. Excuse my English. I mean, it's a little
rusty.
And then I went down to try to, I had been reading about, went down to visit Danilo Dolci, you know, to see his experience. He's an educator, social activist. He was in Partinico, in Sicily, and watched his operations, understood the type of work, felt that through him began to understand that in Italy at that time there was a lot of ferment in education. Schools were changed, school reform was coming through. Child-centered education was becoming more important. I won't say that community participation was a big factor, but one thing that bothered me when I was with him, I don't know why I brought this came up while I was thinking about these experiences. He, one night, had sort of a guru kind of effect, this man, aspect, this man. And we were young, I was 25 years old, a young, just graduated city planner, very little professional experience, but a lot of enthusiasm from many projects that I worked on in Boston, in the North End and in Columbia Point in Boston, working with children, and felt that I could maybe bring something into this area. He said, he forced me one night, we had to read a poetry reading, we read one of his poetries, and he asked me to read one that he had suggested, particularly for me, knowing where I was from, and it said, New York, ti odio, perché, non perché sei città, ma perché pensi di esserla. He couldn't say that to me. I said, I walked out of the meeting at that point. I don't know if people understand what that meant. He said, I hate you, New York, not because you're a city, but because you think you are a city. We opened up a little bit debate about that. So then I quickly ran back to Naples and got rapidly into community action at a very local level in some of the back streets and alleys of the center of the city. Naples at that time was an exciting, it always is an exciting city. I consider it my second, after Brooklyn, my hometown, although I've lived in Perugia for 35 years. I'm much more attached to Naples, and I think probably the relationships I built, not only my wife or through the people that I met there, but this, the city itself, which has what Walter Benjamin called a porous kind of a attitude or sensation that things flow between, there are no boundaries between sacred and profane, between public and private, between people. So the relationships really grow. It's a difficult city, as you know. The children, the scunizzi, the street urchins that we worked with really brought me to know the city. And this is sort of an issue that I think we have to think about. That when people like myself began working with children living in difficult situations and circumstances, or maybe in all communities at that time, children really could be an ally for planners and architects because they knew the city. They were still allowed to go out. They walked about, they knew their neighborhoods, they would show us what they thought were problems, what they thought were resources. Today, that's not the case in most places. Usually, you have to begin a project of participation with a more educational approach, really bringing the children out into the neighborhoods and into the cities to get to know them, and then begin to study and talk with others to understand what the problems or what the solutions might be. But at that time, these children were extraordinary in bringing these kind of ideas to the forefront. Here, I want to give you go into some of the things that children are able of saying or teaching us, telling us. Now remember, I was still in the period when, my romantic period, my utopian period, in which I felt that children could educate adults. They could bring us ideas that would really somehow open up a light bulb and get you to work in a different way in your professions, whatever it might be. As a designer, planner, it happened. The man you see in the picture, Simon Nicholson, I can't not mention because he was an extraordinary professor at Open University, an artist, the son of Ben Nicholson and Barbara Hepworth, who was anti-art and was a person who believed and had written books about the fact that everyone is creative, that everyone, one of the seminal points of his life was that. We met together at a certain point in the United States, and then when we got back to Italy, we were able to put together a research project which twinned, if you can imagine, Oxford, where he was teaching, but the edge of Oxford. He was teaching at the Open University in Oxford, but in a poor neighborhood, working in Oxford and in Naples, we began the Futures Project, which the children in Naples named Gruppo Futuro, and the children in Oxford loved the name so much that they accepted that. And this was before, you know, information technology as we know it, but we were really working in such a way that the children were creating hypertests, they were communicating with faxes, with, what's the word, in a ciclo stile, photocopies, creating books. The idea was just to open the door, you know, didn't necessarily have to be about cities and planning, it was just the future. Because the idea was, already we had understood that the reason for the participation in cities was cities, the future of our cities are colonized by adults, by us. If we make a plan today, decide to build something or decide to begin planning a street, a road, infrastructure, make decisions about the way the economy goes, children that are going to be living that city 20 years from now, 30 years from now, have no say in the work, in the way they will live. So bring them into the process. Break the colonization. Open the door, let them ask questions. The main structure of ours with the children were asking each other's questions. What will the future be like? What will technology be like? And the things that came out were extraordinary, really. Using what was multimedia, collage making, videos made with children, filmmaking with children, photocopies. They anticipated, you're going to think I'm crazy, but I really feel that sometimes children can anticipate the future in terms of really technological, environmental, social issues that you couldn't imagine. We're just in the nucleus there. That now they're at the forefront. But we're talking about 35 years ago. Children were saying that we're in a network. You know, look at the second child, Maria. I think she studied with Andy Warhol. You know, and she's saying that there will be no TV in the future. There'll just be a huge theater in which we're all acting. Or the millions of bells and citofoni on a condo or on a big building that they imagine in the future would be hooked up, but people had to come out, so we're calling them. Sustainability already in England, and not only in England, but in Naples, the kids in the poorest areas were saying the big problem is traffic. I mean, if any of you have been to Naples, it was actually worse then, but there was no way to walk down the street, although everybody and the children were living and playing on the street. And remember, Naples still at that time, at least in the poor areas, had relatively large families. You know, Italy doesn't, apart from what everyone thinks when they think about Italian families, they're usually thinking about Italian-American families. Maybe we've changed too, I don't know, but less than in Italy. Families are very, very small. The population ratio between elderly and children is 1.5 to 1, so there are 150 people over 65 for every person under 18. Very different than developing countries, or probably even the United States, one of the lowest in the world. But Naples still had a large number of children, and some of the poorer areas still have them, and I think that's a good sign. There's dynamism in the society. They felt that nature would certainly invade the city. We had to bring green into the city. We had to bring water into the city. Children always want touchable water, playable water, things that flow, that change. They even the girls, the young girls in Naples were already uncovering, and I have to say, the girl children usually more sensitive to the social relationships, as you can imagine, you know, to the power relationships also. Here they're saying that, you know, okay, architects want to build houses and just make money, you know, but we need bigger kitchens, we need gardens for our children, we need, and I can think of the words, houses that look like houses. That seems like a simple sense, but think about it. I mean, did Pruitt-Igoe look like a house? If somebody lives in a large condominium, you can't identify your window, or you don't know what the relationship between the front door and your apartment is, you can easily get isolated. You can easily get, you need a GPS, you need all kinds of systems to identify yourself. Parents are using this these days, but we can design places, and children want places that are more easily orientable, that are identifiable, that have parts that you understand, okay? This, I think, was extraordinary, really. I have a whole lot of slides of this, but I won't show them, and I didn't put them into the presentation. But when we began talking about the future in an open sense, not just about the city, children really, in England that time, and probably in the United States, were still very frightened by the possibility of nuclear holocaust, okay, that there could be a thermonuclear war, the world would end. It's one of the big issues. In Naples, rightly, the children thought the Vesuvius was the big problem, or maybe an earthquake. This is 1977, no? And the children said, and I won't be reading because I know it so well, that, you know, that's not a problem for our neighborhood, you know, because we know we're behind the hill. I don't think the lava is going to come here. Maybe the earthquake might not even hit us. But every time a building collapses in the center of the city, people come and occupy our schools. and our workplaces and our homes and our piazzas, the little bit of gardens outside, tents come in because it's a poor neighborhood. It's a place where you can access public space. So why don't we prepare some kind of civil defense system, build flexible houses, things that pop out from underground, you know, get things ready. This was, for us, it was a game. I should say that, why were we doing this? We were really trying to get the children to communicate to adults, to create a dialogue we didn't have probably today with, you know, social media that said we could really spread it out. Here there were meetings, posters on walls, post-its all over the place, little stickers, to get people talking in the neighborhood. This issue didn't arrive to the politicians, and it would have been good if it had, because when that happened, when there was an major earthquake in Naples in 1981, in southern Italy, but Naples also, the very thing that they suggested happened. If they had listened to children, it would have been very different. Okay, but remember, we're in Italy, so I don't know what the discourse is here. You know how we Italians are always complaining about our politicians and about a situation that's very corrupt, very inefficient in many parts of the country, and Naples wasn't any different than that. So I wanted to give just a couple of examples how sometimes their visions or their children's ways of behaving rubbed against the skin of the politicians, even in small-scale things. For example, the slide you see there on the left, the little image there, a group of children. What were we doing at that point? After this children, after we opened up sort of the future door, and the issues became, we need more green space, we don't have places to play, maybe people could have better housing, why don't we try to design something? We began working on building, mapping, photographing, and selecting places to imagine another future for. Of course, at that point, we really didn't think that anyone would listen to us. We weren't into a planning process, there were no contracts, they were saying, okay, involve the children and build a playground. That happens today sometimes, and it has happened in Italy very often. It's disappearing now. I'll talk about that later. But at that point, it was just a dream and a provocation, something to provoke discussion. The children put up their posters about it because they're going to have a big meeting about what they wanted to do with a determined small space in the neighborhood. Put it over these posters, were election posters, right? The name of the man is Napolano. Covered his posters. The next day we came back. The children's drawings with the map of where the site was and everything, covered over by his posters. Did it again, next day, election posters up. Talking about it in the community, we discovered that the candidate for the mayor of this town is Marano, near Naples, was the owner, we didn't know that, of the land that the children were suggesting a different use for. He wanted to build a garage or a problem. And we're talking, this is an area that, you know, the Terre di Fuochi, this is the area near the region where Gomorra was written, San Giuliano, Marano, Casal Principe. This is the area that we were working in then. Another case, the children in Rione Traiano, which was a poor neighborhood on the public housing on the outskirts, or actually goes back to Francesco Rossi, because they were the people that were kicked out of the center of the city when the very buildings in the film that Rossi made were being knocked down and re-speculated, not just the hills, but the center of the city. Their neighborhood was created. Happened to be working there. One night they were presenting their ideas for the future of the neighborhood. The meeting starts, something that happens very often, maybe in the United States, I don't know, in New York. In Italy, very, very often, you wait for the dignitaries. You know, they get there last, and often very, very late. The parents were used to those kind of things. The children weren't. They had never been in a public meeting, and they decided at a certain point, after 25 minutes, to start the meeting without the vice mayor, who was supposed to come and listen to his projects. That created quite a stir also. But these kind of things pop about. The thing that was happening, though, is beginning to, and something that characterizes children's projects and why we had to work differently, and I began to move away from the romantic idea that anything the children say is okay and it's good and maybe adults will listen to it. We thought we have to build a more coordinated process to really get these ideas into the mainstream. Small actions, but with very big values and very big dreams. Back to Brooklyn, 1980, 1984, I was teaching across the street here, and when the Graduate Center was right across the street here in the environmental psychology program. And started bringing these future process ideas into studying and understanding more the types of techniques that could be built to create a network around ideas. The children in Red Hook invented a plan for their city. I'm happy to hear for their neighborhood. I'm happy to see that, really, again, talking about the anticipation of the future. These children, talking to the woman here about the past of her future past, what she imagined in the 30s and 40s when Red Hook was built, and it became something very different, and now it's become something different. Now the children in 1984 imagined the coastline dotted by ferries that would go to Manhattan. Correct me if I'm wrong, I think there are some now, okay? Pastures, they haven't gotten to that, but farms, urban farms, there's a lot of urban farming in Red Hook, as far as I know. A cookie factory, Michael said, was a little Italian, the only little Italian boy in an Afro-American Hispanic neighborhood, said, it took us 5 years to build that cookie factory. It was really hard to do it, but we got it together in 2001. And I think there's one of the best cookie shops on the Red Hook Mall now. So I don't know, and again, I'm not saying that these children grew up and became the proprietors of this, but their ideas anticipated the ideas of what planners and architects hadn't thought about at that time. There are many other examples, but then I wouldn't be talking about Italy, and I think Joe would get mad at me, because at Columbia Point in Boston, the very same thing happened. But back to Italy, now we're talking about the late 80s and 90s. I moved back to Italy, and I discover a whole different situation. The ideas which were, you know, just seminal, sort of crazy, small actions were beginning to flow out. There were some major, I should point out that, I don't know if you read that citation, which is from Carlo Pagliarini, who was a founder of Archi Ragazzi, which is one of the groups that's mentioned there. It's the largest youth organization, leftist. In its origin, it was part of the Communist Party, but when that changed, but it always remained the progressive cultural agency of the left in Italy. Archi is the father, or the father, mother, you know, organization Archi Ragazzi. Ragazzi, Archi Kids. There were 1 million children members of this, sort of like scouts, but doing a lot of community action. They began a project which spread around called The City in My Pocket, to get children to explore the city, to understand it, and to begin to talk about things. The World Wildlife Fund, World Wildlife Foundation, asked me to coordinate two projects, which began reactivated the Futures Project that we were doing in Naples with only one neighborhood, began doing this in 1,000 schools all over the country in Italy. So children were imagining the future, communicating through the network, which a national organization do, was arriving in mass media, discussion developed, issues were coming out. The National Research Council, Francesco Tonucci, was an important researcher, and it began a project called La Città Bambina, which was the city of children, which had many of the same themes. Through a coordinated effort, again, INU is the national, you've probably heard this, we're talking about educators, community activists, people linked to cooperative education movement in Italy. We're working together to bring children more into the forefront. But the planners and the architects still weren't there, and the big names were not, where the decisions were being made, were not in the process. In 1994, there was a major conference held in Bologna, in which 300 of the children, 300 children representing probably about 20,000 children from all over Italy, who were working on a World Wildlife Fund campaign called Let's Take Back Our Cities, which activated a lot of the methodology that I haven't gone into here, but which you can imagine. And I think we'll talk about that in a couple of minutes. But this national project really brought children together to talk with planners and architects. So we had a conference of 300 children, 50 commissioners of city planning from different cities, major figures in the National Association of Planners, and they created an agreement, as simple as that, an agreement, signed agreement between the both organizations to impact the government to change some policies. So actually in the late 1990s there was an important planning law passed in Italy which envisioned, and again between words and action there's a big fra dire e fare c'è il mare, we say in Italy, you know, between no? And saying and doing, there's the sea between us, but there was a lot of words coming down there, and they agreed to put some of the factors of children's needs into planning law to bring participation to the forefront. So really in the mid-90s, most of what was going on in Italy around participation and community participation had to do with children, different than other countries. In northern Italy, northern Europe, the stronger movement of community participation and more democratic processes in planning and in city management than in Italy. Children were pushing the forefront. Then the European community arrived and said, it's obliged, you have to have public meetings, public consultations, which if any of you are involved in those, you can know they can be participatory or they can be just sort of rote procedures that agree, create consensus around themes, around decisions which have already been made. There was a worldwide movement at the same time growing. Say hello to Salim, who was involved in that, a friend of mine from around, from UNICEF and from many other aspects, where the Convention of Children's Rights created a precedent. Now, the 12th Amendment in the Charter has to do with participation. It states clearly that children have to be listened to by law around issues that involve them. You probably know many of them have to do with personal issues, divorce cases, family care cases, et cetera. But in planning and city rights, this became an important point. UNICEF developed a huge international project, the Urban Child Project, which tried to disseminate this kind of approach through looking through five cities. I did the synthesis of the research for that project for the Italian case, because if you imagine they were studying India, Brazil, Kenya, and the Philippines, and Italy was supposed to be the conscience of the West to show that even in developed countries, children were not that well off. There are some pockets of poverty, large in some cases, less in other areas in the country, but also in general, children's rights and children's issues were not being recognized. So this study activated a great interest in the Italian parliament, and two very important laws were passed that really opened the door to major participation and major issues. And the second one, I think, was the one I would like to talk about most, was a law that brought funding and financing for, it was called Opportunities and Rights of Children and Youth, and it brought funding around two themes, apart from reinforcing social services, access to schools, et cetera, but it was also very important and revolutionary in a sense because it raised the issue that funds should be brought to the local government to support processes of participatory learning and participation, that the city and the urban spaces were important for children's well-being, and that these should be reinforced. So it really opened up an opportunity for cities to develop processes and programming. Major cities like Naples and Rome, Milano, there were five, they're called assigned cities, usually got something like between 30 and 40 million euros a year for special projects. So you can imagine the type of energy that was going into these procedures. This was in the period of the Prodi government, center-left supported this. Interesting enough also, and probably even more important for the participatory aspects, was the Children Sustainable Cities for Children program, which the Ministry of the Environment brought to a Habitat conference in Istanbul, I think it was, in 1997, and proposed a whole series of guidelines and networking through a UNICEF, an Italian institute in Florence called the Instituto dei Innocenti, an old, maybe some of you know that the oldest childcare institute in Italy. It goes back to 1412, but it's still a place where children's rights and children's well-being are being considered by both nationally and internationally. There was centered the Sustainable Cities Children's Project that brought together resources, training, funding. Universities began to develop programs around these themes. I was the coordinator the first year of that, and three universities created training for 60, 80 architects and planners, primarily women, after there were mostly women planners and architects that came into these themes, which is interesting, and began multiplying an effect. So we had, at a certain point in the late 90s, there were probably thousands. Each year there were awards given to the cities that had created the most child-friendly cities through participation. The first year, 80 cities applied for it. The second year, 300, 400. And the cities that were winning were usually small, medium-sized cities, not as you would imagine just in the north, but also many in the south, in Puglia, near Naples. So the movement was big. And these are the type of areas where people began working. People were working on projects that had to do with play, autonomy. Children's city councils were formed. Some new city, even some areas involved children in city planning processes. Environmental planning, mobility planning, that was a very important issue. Children walk to school programs, trying to create ways that children could be more mobile in the city through their processes. The actions that were usually developed, and the slides I show here have to do with a particular case, although there are not that many pictures. In Milano, after the Urban Child Project, they began a coordinated effort, because one of the main findings, or let's say suggestions, that came out of the Urban Child in Difficult Circumstances research project was that children's issues should be treated on a global theme. There shouldn't be a specific sector that's interested in children's rights. It's not just schools. It's not just health or youth care. It's everything, planning, budgeting, et cetera, and created in many cities, and Milano was the model for this, what were called the Council for Children's Well-Being, which is made up of representatives from each of the city's sectors, plus major figures from organizations that worked around children or environmental-related themes, and began to develop actions and projects to propose to the national law, because I didn't mention, but the national law that's bringing funding was a project-based law, in terms that in order to access 50% of the funds, 50% were for services and for standard uses based on population of the cities. The other 50% was based on project design. So we, through this networking, created participatory projects that involved children in playground design, mobility planning, action, and usually took off from working with the children to reach the working through teachers and community groups to work with children, to then activate the relationship with the communities. And one of the things I hadn't said, forgotten, but was that children are catalysts and synergy figures in a community if we work well. They usually bring information back to the homes, bring their parents to the meetings, dialogue about discussion at some point. Years ago, we discovered in a research project in Europe that probably about 80% of what people knew about green living or sustainability was coming from children talking to their parents about issues that they had heard in school or what they had done in participatory process, the projects that they were developing on their own. So it was really important to create this network going and reach the technical figures. A process of investigating, and that was the future project. What are the questions we want to raise? What are the problems? Let's investigate that problem. Visioning phase, very, very important. The future idea, what do we want? And then take a step back. In order to get to that vision, what do we need to do? I'm sorry that, am I boring you? This is, tell the truth. I'm trying to, too many points. No, it's like too many words and not enough images. But to give you an idea that the structure, we had left the romantic issue and understood that this had to be really the organization of people, collaborative planning. So all the projects had this sort of a framework, a promoting group that developed a project. This on a training, co-planning, and action stage. Workshops with children to develop, get the ideas and bring them out into the community, and then consultations. The children's ideas were always brought into the community to receive approval or be changed. One of the things I hadn't mentioned before was about one of the steps of children's participation in those seven realms. After rights came institutionalization. So when it became a right, children were like just brought into the process, and many cities began to see it as a formal rather than a substantial effect. So on any meeting, you had to have a child sitting at the table with the adults. I don't know if you do that sometimes in meetings here. You know, children's participation is inviting the, quote, best kid in the class to come and say what he wants in a park, or he or she wants in a park. So you see the people saying, if they'd shut up, the kids are making noise out on the street, maybe we'd listen to them. Children are not like that. You know, they want to be heard. Another reality check, 1997, 98, the Urban Child Project in Milano went forward, creating fantastic changes. And the strange thing is that we were working with the first city managed by the Italian League, La Lega, you know, who many of you know. But at that point, there were not, I mean, very ideologically based on certain factors, but very locally based and believed very strongly in participation. So they and probably were maybe stupid in a way. They didn't know what the power of this type of theme could be. So it went through, and they were financing projects, and Milano was changing. Suddenly, one day, and we created a team of 30 people from different sectors, planning sectors, educators, people from associations that were following the development of these huge projects that were bringing about particular changes. People were building, to give a couple of examples, like how it might work, because I probably haven't been that clear, and I excuse myself. At one point, children are deciding in their design projects to create a bicycle path that links where they live to their school. Okay, that's one of the projects. If that had been done in a normal situation where there wasn't a network in the city administration where people who were already following the project from step one were in the administration and working on their offices, things wouldn't have happened because as the people in the offices saw the projects, they realized that they had been doing a bicycle plan project, which, listen to this, didn't pass by the school. So they say, oh, wait a minute, but we have time, let's change it. This is a good idea, children, we have resources for it. Or at a public meeting, children present an idea for another aspect, a series of beautifully designed benches to create sort of public space, which is very interactive in a neighborhood. Public meeting being presented. At the meeting, children's parents are there. So the parents were developers who decided that they could use that in Italy, and I imagine the United States, there's a law that when you do a major development project, you have to contribute, I don't know what it's called in the United States, excuse me, a certain amount of funding to the city, you know, to in order to build infrastructure, to create pieces that connect it. But usually they put it into a slush fund, you know, like you might build a house here and then give 10% of the building costs to the city, and it goes someplace else. The developer said, hey, that's a good idea, why don't we force the city or you know, lobby the city to use the resources that we're giving to them to build the children's playground, bicycle path, et cetera. So integratedly working together with people in real time, creating these kind of networks, allowed these kind of things to happen. What happens from one day to another, the government changes. Berlusconi and his party come in. You probably know about him. Have you heard about Silvio Berlusconi? Not saying that he's guilty of all that's been wrong in the last year, but he kind of represents at the worst level what goes against the grain of democratic planning or democratic operations in general. They arrive, and they were also very ideologically linked to an extreme right Catholic group who claimed, and they said, when they read our papers in which it said children are citizens, they said, no, children are not citizens. Children are children, figli, non come bambini. Therefore, the father, they didn't even say the mother, the father has to decide for them. This is dangerous. You can't get children to. Kicked out from one day to the next. But this totem, I put that up, that's a totem that's in the main station in Milano from 1997 until last year when they renovated the major. And it had on it 15 projects that were written by the Progetto Bambino Urbano group, which had to do with children's city councils, parks being designed by children, playgrounds, housing issues that they had raised, a series of projects which they received funding for, probably around 14 million euro every year for 4 years. None of these things were done. But it was still up on the board for 20 years. So this is kind of give you an idea of the context in which we have had to work. Our group, Abicita, grew out of that. The group that was formed, Abicita, was a group of 20 professionals, city planners, architects, anthropologists, educators, communication experts, all experts in the management of participatory decision making and participatory design. From one day to day two, a bunch of people out of work, let's form a cooperative and start to work on the edge of the city. So we started working in small towns, my colleagues and I, doing organizing children's city councils. There were still the resources available in some of the administrations for this type of activity. Things have gotten worse recently. Funding is gone now, so really a lot has to deal with volunteer work now. Planning issues, design issues, mobility issues, and gradually reinvaded the city, waiting for a favorable administration to have come back, and it did 3 years ago. The whole hinterland was occupied by participatory projects, and then Milano was retaken. And what happened retaken, that's a large statement. But what I'm saying is that children's issues began to fall again into sort of like the background. There wasn't that many resources for this type of work. But at the same time, European planning policy and financing called for participation. So there were major projects in the period between 2000 and 2007 that were funded to do participatory projects. Our group and many others who realized how important children's participation was, put it into the forefront. You know, any projects we do begin with children. Start with them, work with the parents, and then go forward. And this is one example of. Now, here we're in another world, and I think I'm almost closing now. I don't know how much time I have. I've gone, it's probably too long. How much time do I have? Yeah, but I wanted some discussion.
So you have five,
oh God.
8 minutes.
Okay, let's go really quick. Here we're in Reggio Emilia, no? Nearby Correggio, a town where this organization, Abicita, was called in to coordinate the participatory process for the strategic city plan, the mass, I don't remember what it's called in the United States, master plan, or the new city plan. And it was in a city where an organization, a very cooperative region, as you know, lots of cooperative activities, cooperative economic systems, people collaborate. It went fine. You can imagine, usually to organize a meeting with 300 people and 200 children, there's going to be a lot of discussion, a lot of disagreement, a lot of arguing. This area was like a dream because it was an area where the social capital had been so developed through collaborative process in the past. Even one of them had to do with this group, the Andrea Cooperative, which builds housing in the region, had worked through participatory processes in building small public housing projects. What they decided, and this is, we collaborated with them in the late 1990s, to try to develop a decalogo, how you say, sort of 10 rules for houses by children. What should houses be like? And did a participatory research project. The idea wasn't to build something, but to understand it. Simple stuff came out, like I said, houses should look like houses. But those are very important issues if a planner or an architect begins to think about it. And here we have the issues that were developed around this, from this project. And they say that the houses should be transparent. You have to be able to look outside, see the stars. We want to have views towards the city, understand where we are. Hard outside, transparent but hard. Safety, keep the wolf out, keep dangers out, keep the weather out, okay? But it has to be really soft inside. accogliente. You gather, you make you feel at home. Tranquil, peaceful, playful, and you can see the type of housing that was built. Intimate, so that I can find a place to hide, a place to a niche where I can go with my friends. Big, so that we have to have a lot of people sometimes in our house. But at the same time, at the scale of a children's scale, so you understand what's going on. And magical, something that catches me and that changes in time. This group won awards. I mean, they did a series of processes to try to develop a guideline, created a beautiful book in which those themes were analyzed even further. I wrote a part of the book, others did also, to try to analyze what that meant for planners, really to give guidelines to architects on how that could, what could happen if you follow these guidelines. What happened is that in 1904 they received an international award. In 2005, the regional government had a design competition for cooperative housing, which is sort of affordable housing, as we call it, affordable social housing. And they won the award, so they were able to get an amount of money adequate enough to introduce the type of changes that they introduced. And just to give you some of the ideas of what was going on here, this at the top is the tallest building, which had to be seen from everywhere. The neighborhood was developed around the 65 apartments, okay? Row houses and several high rises, 60 apartments altogether. Around an oak tree, which existed already there, so that it could be the identifying point. This tunnel that you see there is where the cars are parked. It's under a hill, because the children had said that there should be a dragon that eats the smog and brings the people in. The architects interpreted as, it looks like a toy. I mean, some architects have criticized it as being sort of Disneyland-like, but it's changing in time. And what you see here is this little girl, that girl there who is 19 now. She was part of the group, the five-year-olds and seven-year-olds that worked 11 years before when the project was being researched and studied. She says that she convinced her parents to buy a house there. The prices are market prices. They're not expensive. They did a good job and is planning to become an architect. She's studying architecture now. So reality check, Naples. I think we'll go through. I think I probably should just show you the pictures and stop because I think you probably... Yeah, but you want some questions or something? That's okay. Okay, but now I'm trying to, because I want to get us back to Naples. I don't think I've gave enough, and I'd like your questions maybe to answer my, to really help me say what I wanted to say, but I've been going around in circles at some point. Is that Naples stays, has evolved. It's the kind of place that can absorb change. I went back two weeks ago, because I wanted to see, haven't worked there recently, but I wanted to see what was going on. And I noticed that in many aspects it remained the same. It still had this dynamism in the back streets, a lot of people, but it had been invested with probably the best subway system in Italy, beautiful system. A lot of money was spent, maybe too much, to create these works of art, but they're being kept up pretty well. Beautiful, you can get around really quickly. There are still signs of movements that were there in 1975 when I were there, some organized groups. Homeless next to, I guess like New York or any major city, next to places for electric cars, so like the future and the past are still together. And the thing that really hit me the most was that it seemed like, again, we had gone back to Naples as the center of local action beyond the institutions, because there's a place, I don't know if any of you know Pino Daniele, perhaps some of you have called Isopats. One of his favorite songs. He died recently, as you know. And this group occupied an criminal mental institution. Excuse my English. Manicomio criminale, some of you understand that. To create a center for children and begin local action to start the process again. And to try to keep up hope, you know, to keep us going, that things can change. It's, they went back to children. They went back to oggi voglio parlare. I'd like to talk, I'd like to be listened to. And quickly to say things, you know, the struggle continues. Italy is not an easy place like any place. They did a lot of action. institutions listened at times. It depends on the process, the local makeup. But I think things have changed. I've managed to do sort of like a longitudinal research, intuitive research project, meeting often people, children who had 30 years ago worked in these projects and are now social activists, opened a cooperative movie theater through crowdfunding, et cetera. A lot of the modern events that are occurring, the changes that are trying to go forward to make our cities different and more democratic, I think probably the physical changes didn't occur as we had hoped, although I could have shown some slides of beautiful places, I didn't. But the social aspects changed. Children and youth through those processes learned that they can be protagonists in deciding together with others the future of their neighborhoods. And I hope to continue in the future. Thank you.
What's the birth rate these days in Italy?
Pretty low. I don't know exactly. It's probably about 1.3 children per family. Yeah. I think it's the lowest. It's the lowest in Europe. Immigrants are increasing the population. I didn't say in Naples that half of the areas that we worked in are now Sinhalese from Ceylon or from Costa Verde, China, etc. So children, most of the children you see on the streets these days, not in Naples but in other cities, are immigrant children. There are quite a few of those, of them.
Yeah. I'm a gerontologist, so I'm at the other end of the spectrum. And here in New York City, we have a movement towards age-friendly cities.
Yes.
And I wonder if you see some intersection between the work you've been doing and what we're trying to accomplish.
Yes, I do see it very. Should I answer? We answer one-to-one, like this just right through, or wait for? Okay. No, certainly. I'm sorry I didn't mention that, but often children, when they create a participatory process, are very democratic. They don't want to decide just for themselves. They work with others. And one of the figures that they go to most often are the elderly. They find tremendous exchange and understanding what life was in the past. And also, I think that's probably your question, the things that they're suggesting, accessible streets, places that are easy to cross, traffic being stopped, green spaces, places to sit, you know, things that once upon a time made up a city. And maybe many of you imagine that Italy is like that, but the piazzas you see that are so beautiful are usually tourists sitting in there. They're not the people, or certainly not people with children in those piazzas. But anyway, yes, and there have been many projects of collaboration between children and elderly for many reasons. I won't go on to it, but there's others also. So the sort of values that an older generation has concerning development or the relationship with the land, with food, certainly a way of jumping over, let's say, that 40-year age group that changed things. Go on.
Hi. I'm Jane Politi.
Hi, Jane.
To begin with, it's wonderful what you've been able to do with the children and hearing their voices and putting that into city planning. I think it's marvelous. I'm on the NGO Committee on Migration, and I deal at the UN, and I deal in particular with children's issues. Mm-hmm. And of course, we're dealing with the refugee crisis, in particular from Syria right now. And we were sitting around a table yesterday thinking, because one of the plans is looking at alternatives to refugee camps.
Yes.
And so we're sitting around talking about this and, you know, how the community, neighboring communities could integrate, in particular the children, thinking of the smallest children. And I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, well, what would the children say?
Yeah.
What would the children want? And here you are today.
Yeah.
And I'm asking you, do you create a city like, you know, one of your abicita?
Uh-huh.
Do you work on policies and practices to help integrate children and their families in the neighboring communities where they settle? What do we do with these millions of very needy humans?
That's a big issue, but I think what we do, and many all of the things you mentioned, we do, but in different contexts, in different settings. I think the first thing is to really try to and Salim, maybe you've met Salim, he works on some of these issues also, sitting next to you, is asking the children and developing processes to involve them in it. You'll find that it will help, even in a series, I think, in a moment of crisis, children working together, being creative with their parents, can even in the intermediate period when they're in the camps, create a better life, a greater atmosphere of hope, no? The problem is then to develop those ideas, you know, and there the questions are resources, bureaucracy, time, energy, I don't know. There's the example I gave was sort of provocation, is that the word? So to provoking the idea of the neighborhood designed on the basis of only children's needs, which wasn't the case, because we saw that that neighborhood fits very well for elderly, and all families are happy in that neighborhood. But you need time. You need the courage, I think, really, to open up and listen and give children and adults also, because it's not just children. Their parents have to come into this, and everyone, the stakeholders in the community and outside the community have to be in this. Have to be able to learn to work cooperatively in a hurry, and activate small projects that then become bigger ones. I don't think I answered your question, but I hope that I've helped. It's a big issue, and yes. I'd like to talk to you later about it.
Hi, Erica Moretti. I have a quick question. A couple of years ago, there was an exhibit at the MoMA titled Growing Up by Design, and it was about interior designing, and the exhibit actually started with the furniture elaborated by Alessandro Marcucci mm-hmm. and Maria Montessori. I'm wondering whether you also work on interior design and whether you go back to what seems to be the roots of children designing and listening to the children's needs for the interiors of houses. And
we haven't done much interior design, but the issues are the same. And Montessori, I think, taught us that, you know, in a way, the scale of the images. Children have done a lot of. I have to say, the children, although their images are enormous, they're thinking about from flying cities to underground cities to places that are perfectly like medieval villages, almost in a way. But the details are what they like to work on, and often we've done design of furniture and play places with them, and they're usually simple, common sense, low cost also. This is one of the issues that children work on. One I can think of in particular was called, it was called the Banco Serpente, like a snake. And I imagine, oh God, this is gonna look like Gaudi. It was beautiful, you know, it's you know, sort of built. The children didn't imagine. What they meant was that it just had to be two loops so people could look at each other. To give you a simple idea, you know, so you could sit on either side and have facing, so then you don't have the situation where teenagers justly take a bench and rip it up and turn it around so that you can sit facing the people. Maybe the architect or the planner could have thought that they should have been in the same, you know, in a more sociable sort of setting.
Angie Bartolome, complimenti. This is very, very interesting, very impressive. Since it could serve as a model, I'm wondering if there have been any international organizations such as UNESCO or the European Union that have used it as a model and also been supportive financially to creating mm-hmm. and duplicating this.
UNICEF actually has been very supportive of this. So there's an international movement called and program of UNICEF called Child Friendly Cities, which listed out nine factors that go into making child-friendly cities. One of them is participation, and have tried to create processes and to involve children not only in designing the cities, but in evaluating their cities. But sometimes that's as important, because not designing implies that you're going to change something, so you need resources to change things. But you can also improve situations through participatory evaluation. And children have been in many countries, even more so in so-called, you know, minority countries, the majority countries, and the Philippines or in India, these things are going on, and they're very active. Brazil has been active in the forefront, and UNICEF, till a few years ago, finances these things. I think it was a little less now. There's a squeeze on, but there's a movement at heart, and some of the old guys were still trying to keep it going and hoping that the younger generation comes along and picking it up. And I think that's happening. That's what I've noticed from my children or others of that age group that I work with, are some of the values that we're really passing through in the 90s, in the late 90s. So we have kids that are like millennial, like from 18 in 2000, had gone through, many of them, processes of participation and thinking about cities that impacted their lives, and they're beginning to take up on these kind of issues.